This is me from just a couple years ago. And I got my PhD from Caltech in 2004. And I know who my advisor is. And it's this guy, Jerrold Marsden, who got his degree at Princeton in 1968. But with the wonder of computers, you can now ask questions like, who was my advisor's advisor? And so his advisor was this guy named Arthur Whitman, who got his degree in Princeton in 1949. His advisor was a guy named John Wheeler, a physicist who did a bunch of stuff with gravity. He came up with the adage, matter tells space how to curve and curve tells matter how to move. He had several other famous students, Richard Feynman, a physicist, and Kip Thorne. Feynman did quantum electrodynamics. Wheeler's advisor was this guy named Carl Hertzfeld. I don't know much about him, but he got his degree in Europe, Universitat Wien, which means Vienna. And then, he was co-advised, so it gets interesting. Let's look at this branch. Over here, we got somebody. You notice the pictures are getting older, and we're in the 1800s. 1896, this guy, and then 1871, Exner, and then August Kunt, 1864, and then Heinrich Gustav Magnus, who he's the one who came up with the Magnus effect. You know, if you hit a tennis ball with topspin. So that's him, 1800s, and yeah, that just kind of goes on and on. Let's go back to the other branch of Mr. Hertzfeld. Arnold Sommerfeld. He was a physicist from University Königsberg, and he had a student, Heisenberg, came up with the uncertainty principle, and also Wolfgang Pauli, who also did some stuff with quantum. And Pauli, there's some physicist alive now named Polkinghorne, who was also advised by Dirac, and his student was Hawking. And then Hoyle had something to do with, I think Fred Hoyle was making fun of the universe having a beginning by calling it the Big Bang, but then the name stuck. Dirac somehow academically descended from Rutherford and Thomson and Lord Rayleigh. And then Lord Rayleigh was co-advised by Routh and Stokes. And they all were advised by Sedgwick, and there's also Maxwell, John Clerk Maxwell, and Sedgwick goes up to Newton, and then there's Halley and Hooke from Hooke's Law. So there's some weird connection to the to the English side. Most of this will stay European. So Sommerfeld was advised by some guy named Lindemann, who one of his students was Hilbert, the mathematician, and one of Hilbert's grand students was Banach. And then this guy's advisor was Klein, who came up with that weird bottle called the Klein bottle. And what was a mathematician at Virginia Tech who's related to him through Prandtl, who did stuff with fluids. Trion Iliescu is in the math department. Klein, co-advised. So it's gonna be interesting. Let's look at this branch. Julius Pflücker, I don't know who that is. Christian Gerling. Don't know, but we're getting into woodcuts and stuff. Oh, he was advised by Gauss. So there's Gauss. That's cool. Gauss also advised Bessel of Bessel functions and some guy named Frobenius. Gauss was advised by Pfaff, you know, the Pfaffian form of writing the constraints. There he is. There's Johann Pfaff. He also advised Mobius, the Mobius strip, and was advised by Bode of the Titius-Bode law, where the planets are. And let's just not go that way. I had a student who originally put this together because they were just curious. So the other co-advisor of Klein was Rudolf Lipschitz, of Lipschitz, some kind of constraint on derivatives, right? He was co-advised. On this side, we have Martin Ohm, not named after the Ohm in electricity. That was his brother. This guy did other things. And then Langsdorff. And then, Abraham Costner, who I guess also advised this guy, Pfaff. Yeah, may as well follow that other branch. So Costner also advised Thibault, who advised Dirksen, who advised Jacobi of the Jacobi constant, who advised George Gordon, who advised Emmy Noether of Noether's theorem. So it's all connected. Person to person, this stuff gets handed down, right? So the other advisor of Lipschitz was Dirichlet. You've also heard of Dirichlet boundary conditions, I would think. Dirichlet also advised someone named Sophus Lee, who had a co-advisor, Riemann geometry. Dirichlet had two co-advisors, pretty substantial figures too. On one side is Poisson, oh my goodness, who advised a whole bunch of people that's related to Birkhoff, Koopman, Poincaré, and so on. I can post this, you can look at it. His other co-advisor is Fourier. Imagine having Fourier and Poisson breathing down your neck. Fourier also advised Navier, the Navier-Stokes law. But Navier was mostly an engineer. So they both were advised by Lagrange. Now, we're in 1750, University of Torino. Lagrange also advised Cauchy, who did a lot of stuff with continuum mechanics. But wait, let's look at Poisson. Poisson was also advised by Laplace. He looks like a commander there. And Laplace was advised by D'Alembert. Cool. And D'Alembert just sort of emerged from the mist. But he advised Legendre and Galois. Who advised Lagrange? Well, you could probably guess Euler. There we go. There's Euler. Colorful paintings. Who was advised by... There's a famous Bernoulli family. So this is Johann Bernoulli. And then he was advised by Jacob Bernoulli. These are the mathematician Bernoullis, not the Bernoullis from fluids. That was like their brother or uncle or something. These guys did the Bernoulli. One of them did the Bernoulli, probability distribution. And Bernoulli was advised by the inventor of calculus himself, Leibniz. He did other stuff too, though. And Leibniz was co-advised. One of them was Christian Huygens. Remember the one who came up with the... that feedback system. He also did some things related to Saturn, so there's a probe named after him. And then the other co-advisor is Jacob Thomasius, who I think was just a pure theologian. And then this goes, it's all connected. There's this Christian Hausen guy down here who was the advisor of Kastner, and he is connected to Kepler. So, and then Tycho Brahe, because Kepler used Tycho Brahe's data to figure out the laws of motion. And then we get to theologians like Erasmus, but then also there's Copernicus. And there's Descartes and then Thomas A. Kempis. It goes all the way back, if you're wondering. It's called the Mathematical Genealogy website. You can find it. And it goes all the way back to like the 1100s.